here today. It's my honor and pleasure to welcome you to the 2023 Community Lecture Series. This series, now on its 25th year, showcases some of the outstanding faculty here at the university and the work they do in advancing research and learning. We will begin with the university's statement of acknowledgement. The University of Montana acknowledges that we are on the Aboriginal territories of the Salish and Coast Belt people. Today, we honor the past that have always shown us and cared for this place for generations to come. Now that we are back to what not exactly why this first dimension format, we'll find something new with respect to ticketing, and we're hoping that next week this form will have abated and we'll be back at the University Center for a live lecture. But rather than list the price for a ticket, we invite you who are joining these lectures to say what you think is worth to you. We suggest $30 for the whole series or $10 for individual lectures. We hope you will determine yourself for value. It is a risk, we know, but we're confident that you can figure out for yourself what you'll gain in learning and enjoy. And, as always, if you know someone who will enjoy these lectures here with us or over at Zoom conference, please feel free to spread the word. If you haven't already registered, please do so through the University Alumni Association website. These lectures are being video recorded by our friends at Missoula's community.
Recording in progress.
Research Source Center. For later tablecasts, posting to YouTube. Later on, during our Q&A sessions, we'll be asking you to ask your questions in the chat function. And please pose your questions to everyone so that everyone can see your question, what we ask our speakers. Now, I would like to present a special presentation from University of Montana President Seth Wagner.
Hello, welcome to the University of Montana Alumni Association. It's wonderful to be here today. 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 It's
thank you, President Wagner. The committee has selected Dr. Tim Nichols, the Dean of the Davidson Honors College, to open our series. Dr. Nichols' academic background includes a degree in agriculture, a degree in adult and continuing education, and a Ph.D. in sociology. He has devoted himself to the task of mentoring and inspiring students in research, which please join me in welcoming Dr. Nichols as he presents his lecture, Minds Bold and Hearts Open, Research the Ways of Knowing and Hunger, UAE. Dr. Nichols.
Well, good evening. Let's start in Plato's case. Right, please. In a familiar allegory, Socrates tells the story of lifelong prisoners chained in a cave. Because they cannot move, all they can see are shadows cast upon the cave wall lit by a firefighter's gun. This is the only world they know. They have no sense of or knowledge of the world outside the cave. As the allegory unfolds, one of the prisoners breaks free and escapes the cave. Out in the real world, he is blinded by the sunlight. He is lost, uncomfortable, and fearful in the ever-present world. Eventually, he becomes accustomed to it, and he delights in the beauty, wonder, and complexity of his new reality. Excited to share this new world, the prisoner returns to the cave to liberate his friends, and at first has trouble adjusting back to the darkness. He finds his former fellows skeptical, resentful, and denying the light, the beauty, and the bright possibilities that wait for him above the ground. Slide, please. The Italian physicist and philosopher Carlo Rovelli writes in his beautiful, reality is not what it seems, the journey to quantum gravity, that we are all in the depths of a cave, chained by our ignorance, by our prejudices, and by our weak senses, reveal only shadows. If we try to see further, we are confused, we are unaccustomed, but we tremble. This is science. Scientific thinking explores and redraws our world, gradually offering us better and better images of it, teaching us to think in ever more effective ways. Science is this continual exploration of new ways of thinking. Its strength is its visionary capacity to demolish preconceived ideas, to reveal new regions of reality, and construct new and more effective images of the world. This adventure rests upon the integrity of past knowledge, but at its heart, the world is boundless and iridescent. We want to see it. We are immersed in its mystery and in its beauty, and over the horizon, there is unexplored territory. The incompleteness of our knowledge, the precariousness suspended over the abyss of the immensity of what we don't know, does not render our life meaningless. It makes it interesting. Interesting and precious. I love that. Sounds like research and ways of knowing to me. As someone who spent 30 years in higher education, the case that was always common has been resonated with, inspired, and remind me of the power, importance, and sacred obligations of our world. The allegory came quickly to mind when I was asked to speak this evening, teaching at the University of Montana Alumni Association's Community Lecture Series. My name is Tim Nichols, and I'm privileged to serve as Dean of the Davidson Honors College at UAE, and I'm delighted to be here. Thanks for joining via Zoom on this blustery winter's middle, and special thanks to Katie Roberts, Peggy Poore, and Jeff Dobby, and to my colleagues at the Alumni Association, and special thanks to Veronica for the help with the slides, for their kind invitation to be part of this year's sequence. Well, I'll admit, my first reaction to the index was, are you sure that you got it? Your interest and assurance and support is felt now. I'm deeply grateful. Here it goes. Next slide. No talk about research at the University of Montana would be complete without referencing as President Bob Mason. The recent dramatic, historic success of the institution's research and creative scholarship. As folks have undoubtedly heard by now, just about a year ago, UAM was named a Research One University, a permanent classification indicating very high record record year, already having brought in from $126 million in the 2022-2023 fiscal year. Vice President Wittenberg also says to us, Center for Translational Medicine is recently among the best universities for solving the coronavirus pandemic. Scott gives all the credit for the success to UN faculty who are addressing national and planetary needs in ways that help drive local and regional economic and workforce development. Next slide. At a recent university leadership council meeting, D.P. Wittenberg highlighted five big wins in research at UN. And while I'm not personally involved in this work, I thought you'd appreciate just a glance at some of the research teams that are contributing tens of millions of dollars each to that research mission. From my view, it's impressive and fascinating stuff, and certainly relevant to this evening's discussion. Next slide. Free-range human physiology is the focus of the Montana Center for Work Physiology and Exercise Metabolism, which studies human performance in high-stress environments such as Wyoming and Firefox. The lead investigator here is Dr. Brett Ruby. Next slide. Dr. Monica Serban leads the Montana Biotechnology Center aimed at developing biotech workforce and product opportunities, specifically medical devices and therapeutics for rural and limited resource areas. The Montana Climate Office is led by state climatologist Preston Jester, whose impressive methodologies include the grant dashboard and impact on mitigation strategies across sectors, geographies, and communities. Next slide. Cyber Montana is directed by Diana Fett. The center is aimed at developing a cyber workforce for the state to provide special contract support for the Montana National Guard. And finally, theory. The Center for Integrated Research on the Environment focuses on interdisciplinary natural resource and wildlife solutions across state, federal, private, and tribal lands. Their latest study is a multi-million-dollar award from the Army Corps of Engineers focused on cultural resources. Some pretty impressive proof points. Next slide. Equally impressive to me is the work of big U.S. brother defense groups, which takes this excitement of discovery to the Missoula community and beyond. Through a brand new focus of undergraduate research and creative scholarship, the Spectrum Discovery Area in the Missoula Public Library, and outreach through the We Are Montana in the Classroom program. The book team takes this mind-blowing work to the streets, to the people, and throughout our communities and states, leveraging broader impact and answering the all-important question often posed to academic researchers. Next slide. A four-year framework for scholarship and theories. It moves beyond the scholarship of discovery to the scholarship of application, of teaching and learning, and the scholarship of integration. So what exactly does all this have to do with me and the Davidson Honors College? Before I continue, let me share a bit of background on the mission, vision, and values of the DHC. Next slide. Founded more than 30 years ago, the Davidson Honors College is a vibrant and inclusive intellectual community providing transformative educational opportunities and dedicated to strengthening their positive impact on the world. We engage diverse students through distinctive educational experiences that fuel growth and empowerment and position our students for success. We are respected for our innovative and impactful approaches, individual and collaborative scholarship, integrity, and holistic student support. We lift one another up in our positive force in the lives of our students, our campus, our community, and the world. We deploy thoughtful, informed, cultural, and accomplished citizens. The things like thinkers and doers, explorers, creators, servants, leaders, and agents of positive change. Through curricular and co-curricular experiences, we are equipped with new ways of knowing, seeing, doing, and being in the world. Through the experience in the community, we build capacity for collection, analysis, and synthesis of information, with excellence in the oral, written, interpersonal, and digital communication. Independent and collaborative work, problem solving and community engagement, writing and reflection about our own and others' experiences, ethical, original, creative, and critical connection, and a meaningful life and future personal and professional success. The DHC has more than 200 talented and motivated students from across the state, nation, and world who represent all the different majors that you have. And we are growing. Even during recent years, when the university was struggling with the moment, class numbers were on the rise. And now, the DHC has proven itself as a positive enrollment driver for increasing quantities of high-quality students for you. And it's helping to shape the university's future as an institution where smart kids who want to make a difference go for a world-class education. As dean of the DHC, I have a unique perspective on research at the University of Montana because all of our students come free to custom project, and original piece of scholarly and creative work is conducted with guidance from a faculty mentor. We have been in a public scholarly venue at the local, regional, and national, even in the national level, and published on UN ScholarWorks platform or another peer-reviewed outlet. Along the way, we enhance the subject matter knowledge, certainly, but we also build capacities for critical thinking and problem solving, communication, and teamwork, diversity, and leadership. It's mind-blowing and heart-opening work for sure. And I'm lucky to have a front row seat to these transformative educational journeys. Next slide. Like the journey of Devin Hunt, a microbiology and biology double major who studied, wrote textbook chapters with research on everything from bacteria to fetus, conducted vaccine studies at the National Institutes of Health, and this fall was one of 12 students in the country admitted to the MD-PhD program at Johns Hopkins University. He also got a perfect score in his MCAT exam. For a student like Nicole Beaver, who has conducted research on deer, on mountain lions and their kittens, big orange sheep, and then rams across the Western United States, who studied intensively in French last summer, and students mouth for fun in their free time. Or Kayla Heinrich, who studied history and computer science, and who is now one of the country's leading young thinkers on the ethical implications of artificial intelligence. Or Beatrice Brazil from Tulsa, UN's latest Taylor and Marshall scholar, who studied gender equity issues among student workers at UN, and most recently led a team researching barriers to outdoor recreation in previous underrepresented groups. Remaining my former student, now student success coordinator for the DHC, Andy Joseph, who studied music composition and climate change studies, he wrote a piece to be performed using recycled parts from an old mountain bike to figure out the algorithm for Rubik's Cube to compose a piece for piano reflection. Next slide. For DHC graduate and current sociology master's student, Lee Frank Corey, who struggled with his own mental health and eventually dropped out of college, cobbling enough money together by fighting fires in the summer to keep during the winter. But eventually, Luke's great mind and big heart triumphed to be home. His groundbreaking touchstone project explores systemic issues and social factors surrounding the economic, physical, mental, and social well-being of one. Go on. And I will say this now, but these students and hundreds of others like them, their intellect, imagination, and integrity, and their hard work and honesty, remain nothing short of inspiring. Gavin, Nicole, Kimball, Luke, Steve, and their peers, and the scholars whose work has cited for you are well prepared for balancing careers of meaning and impact, because they've embraced the challenges that lie at complicated intersections in multiple disciplines and, as we will discuss, ways of knowing. In other words, they have no other case. That's right. Solutions to the world's biggest problems are going to be solved by solo scholars quietly chipping away in their academic silos and unruly towers. It's when these silos come together in the powers crumble, that disciplines can come together in novel, innovative ways at the intersections of knowledge, where tomorrow's biggest and most impactful discoveries wait. Last year, the DHC made an honors interdisciplinary course a requirement for graduation with university scholar distinction. We stood up a compelling lineup of courses on topics ranging from democracy to sound, to water, to law, to curiosity. For a while, the arts faculty thought it was the requirement that every new course could only have a one-word title. But they go on, energy and climate, food justice, literature and medicine, social ecology, and the Montana course, to name a few. I have to say from my view, while it takes a bit of courage and a healthy dose of both intellectual confidence, humility, teaching and learning in these interdisciplinary environments is as good as it gets. Perspectives from the sciences, the arts, the humanities, the social sciences, and the community enrich students and faculty perspectives, enliven the classroom, teach students on the edges of the seat, challenge their previously held assumptions, and push the learning community out of their comfort zones towards solutions. Students in my love class read Plato, Dolphin, Toby Morrison, Helen Fisher, and the Seaside Story. They consider poetry in greater scales. They collect and analyze data on original research questions and write their own creative nonfiction love stories. Students in the DHC's water course learn about water's role in the history of human civilization, along with contemporary water policy controversies. They explore hydrology, forest, climate, learning inspiring stories of cleaning up the Clark River, and reclamation of what is known as Milton's Park. They hear from the likes of artists, creative writers, state policy makers, beer-making entrepreneurs, and tribal natural resource professionals. For their final creative piece, one team last fall wrote and performed a multimedia musical presentation in honor of Lonesome Larry, the last Sockeye salmon on Idaho's Red Cliff Lake. One of our honors experiences, Quest, Questions for Undergraduates Exploring Social Topics, works with local governments at the city and county levels here in Missoula, and puts interdisciplinary teams of students to work in a significant challenge facing the community each year. Think affordable housing, zero waste, systemic racism, climate change, constituent communication. After an academic year of research and engagement, students pitch ideas for proposed solutions to a panel of community issues. The way to change and internships to implement their ideas. The honors journey begins, if you will, with a foundational academic course
and the world according to unclean. Humans come to know what they know through language, through sensory perception. That is through sight, hearing, sound, taste, touch, memory, through emotion, reason, imagination, faith, intuition, and memory. Interesting how this approach complements Freudian's research around multiple intelligence, through which he argues that there are different ways in which people can be smart. According to Gardner, people can be visually and spatially intelligent, linguistically and verbally intelligent, interpersonally intelligent, and transpersonally intelligent. Logically and mathematically intelligent, musically intelligent, following you kinesthetically intelligent, and naturalistically intelligent. Next slide. This view also connects to previous research around learning styles, which identifies four predominant types of learners: visual learners, auditory learners, reading and writing learners, and kinesthetic learners. Some drop level, all of this makes sense, doesn't it? We all have some sense of the ways in which we learn, the ways in which we might be intelligent, and the ways in which we like to learn. Perhaps you've been considering your own preferences and dominant styles as I've been rattling them up this evening. The key point here is that there are multiple perspectives, multiple ways, multiple styles. And while traditional academic systems have projected favored style over others, a more extensive understanding may bring for a more diverse and dynamic student body and a more inclusive, holistic learning environment. And that reminds me of the good thing. That's what we strive for in the TC. Next slide. On the topic of a more inclusive environment, remember the stories that as a boy, Einstein struggled with math. And the little girl who couldn't sit still in class, she went on to become an internationally acclaimed teacher in choreography. Next slide. The TNC's ways of knowing course challenges students to explore and reflect on the human experience from ancient to contemporary times in relation to self, society, the environment, and the world. This seminar-style course facilitated by some of the finest instructors anywhere, and with text ranging from the fight of Jessica to the Davidson, Greek epics and tragedies, the Book of Job, the Scribe, Shakespeare, Robin Wall Kimmerer's Braiding Sweetgrass, and Raskin's Book of Delights. Students engage in lively, mind-blowing, and heart-opening dialogues each week. As a special treat this year, Ms. Lewis and State Conductor Julia Tye spoke to all the sections of Voice of Knowing with the perspective of music of the Voice of Knowing. And so our students gain insights on how to live, not just scientifically, but also cosmologically, sociologically, and pedagogically, through myth, through stories, through philosophy, through poetry, songs, and great works of literature. Next slide. I think that it's wonderful that this year's community lecture series similarly reflects a range of epistemologies. Those of you who keep coming back for the sequence will be treated to your very first honors course, including Dr. Zubana, whose work I previously cited in my discussion of UNC Twins, Associate Professor of Pharmaceutical Sciences, and Harnessing the Power of Knowledge. Biological Sciences Professor Mike Minnick, coming from South America's Master's Divine Channel, revealing the secrets of a neglected bacterial field killer. Associate Professor Polish Ron Hill on Creative Writing, The World is Yours, and Professor Julia Galloway on Ways of Knowing, Ways of Discovering, and Ways of Art Making.
these multiple ways of knowing may sound fascinating and fun, it doesn't mean it's always easy. In fact, encountering different ideas, voices, histories, and perspectives can be downright unsettling. Our most powerful learning experiences can be painful. Because listening respectfully to someone with whom you disagree means that you're open to the possibility of being wrong. And being wrong and authentically encountering the truth of others has the potential to drop one's proverbial weight. So along with growing minds and opening hearts, sometimes the tendency within the world like in business and from my view, what's it going to do? I recall some of these moments in class. A room full of environmentally focused students who were presented with some of the racist views of the movement's forefathers and the native speaker who called the very validity of the term wilderness into question. A group struggling to find any form of love in the story of a fugitive slave who chose to end the time to prevent her from returning to a life of bondage. First year students can introduce them to honors, grappling with the question, what does it mean to be honorable anyway? And students of the Montana course, wrestling with issues around sovereignty, climate change, economics, and world poverty and homelessness, values we share as residents of this great state. One of my goals as dean of the Davidson Honors College is to create a brave space where students thoughtfully and rigorously and critically dialogue across differences in perspectives, ideologies, politics, and belief systems in healthy, respectful, transformative ways that open skills in listening, compassion, and empathy. Will the world be a better, more just and loving place if we all have the opportunity to learn a little bit more about listening, compassion, hospitality, and empathy, right along with what we're learning about biology or business, about something you're fun with to your physics, music, and math? Next slide. My relationship with tribal people and perspectives is a personal example for me of how encountering a different way of knowing and being in the world has been one that has fundamentally changed and enriched my life. For 27 years, I've worked closely with tribes and tribal colleges across a wide range of projects relating to higher education in the food, agriculture, human, and natural sciences. The Lakota term, Metakiyawasa, offered as a greeting, a farewell, and any man, roughly translates to all my relatives, and speaks to the Lakota sense of connectedness with all that is, embracing as relatives the two-legged, four-legged, the wind, the rock, the grass, the water, the sky. Bolivia's Montgomery Quechuan people's reverence for Pachamama, from Mother Earth, reflects a similar worldview. Rodelli argues as a quantum physicist that the nature of man is not his internal structure, but the network of relationships and interactions within which he exists. How differently might our behaviors be if we were to see our students as nieces and nephews, our adversaries as family members, picking plants as caring for plants, as those who were sent to take care of us, to see us as our environment, as our relative, and if we were to accept and seek to more deeply understand the powerful sense of interconnectedness that brings us all together. For a kid who grew up Catholic, I'm sure your kid was too loving, hardworking, but at the end of the day, pretty darn conservative Christians. These ideas have been revelatory in my life. one of my mentors wrote these words. In the beginning is the Word. Everything is related to everything else. Language is discovery. Ceremony is essential. Life at its best is a celebration of mystery. Being religious is often very different from being spiritual. Time is given in night and seasons. Clock and calendar times may be societally necessary, but they are often reductive disruptions. Past is not past. Silence is the larger context for words. Silence speaks. Process is usually more important than the result. Children, spontaneous, receptive as teachers. Elders, reflective, contemplative as teachers. Ego reduces the chances of creating anything else. Knowledge without wisdom is common, is destructive. Life is seriously funny. Human is necessary for survival. Chaos is created. And first speaks. Diversity together is the greatest strength. Sympathy has often been the problem. Empathy is the solution. The circle follows, the circle heals. The promise is in the pain. There is courage and compassion, and there is hope. Students at Davidson Honors College also inspire hope of me through exciting experiential learning opportunities, including internships, study abroad, undergraduate research, and creative scholarship, and service learning. And it's the next element of the curriculum where the rubber meets the road. The students' big ideas and aspirations come head on with the real world. Here, they put the numbers to work. Next slide. I'm so proud of our students on the leading edge of discovery and those who rise quickly to positions of influence in politics and industry, but I'm equally so proud of those who work for the Nature Conservancy in Tanzania, who direct Missoula's food bank, who serve as a children's advocate for Missoula's wife this year, as an after school tutor for Spike Blanding, who advocate for incarcerated youth. Develop programs for refugees to the International Rescue Committee. Those who clean up the riverbanks on chilly Saturday mornings, and those who canvass and collect thousands of pounds of food from the University District and Tokyo Precinct, so must we look at. And even those who sign on with former President Insta to assist with the Rotary Water Quality Project in Guatemala. Next slide. As Dr. King said, we never stand so tall as when we bend to hold another. That's right. Just as mighty glory can rock our intellectual knowledge, heart opening sometimes starts with heartbreak. Parker Palmer, the beloved author, educator, and activist, writes that his heart being broken open. He says this can happen in 2 years. In one way, the brittle heart shatters, but there is another way. Imagine, he said, the clenched fist of the heart broken open into the largeness of light, into greater capacity to hold our heart in the world's pain and joy. That heartbreak can become a source of compassion and grace. The supple, broken open heart can give rise to the politics generosity, the politics of common strength as worthy of human spirit. To frame my view, especially during times of an epidemic loneliness and a host of mental health challenges facing young people today, being a source of compassion and grace is certainly an honorable aspiration. And besides, what are we supposed to do when we get out of the just hang out and soak up some other rivers, chill under a tree and enjoy living the life of a hunter. In the DHC, we believe members of our community have an obligation to give back. Each of these like towns and surface to others. So our commitment to growing minds, opening hearts, and rocking waves continues. Considered one of my greatest calls as an educator, but want my students and colleagues, for that matter, to find and make meaning in their studies and work. Holocaust survivor Viktor Frankl, another of my favorite authors, said that meaning in life comes through our work, through our suffering, and through our relationships. So our journey is not just about getting there, learning the stuff, getting all the answers right. It's about asking the right questions and finding and making meaning from the knowledge, experiences, ideas, and people who come our way. Next slide. And there for me is the heart of the matter of honors as you are here. You are. We are in a relationship with one another. We are in it together. We learn, we work, we laugh, we hike at 6:30 a.m. Friday mornings, we serve kids who come join us, we have open mic nights, we travel, we play sleepy and we serve, and we represent UN on the state, regional, national, and international levels of honors education. Next slide. When I ask students at the beginning of honors experience what they want from us, they often describe perks such as early registration, scholarship opportunities, and small classes. But in their graduation senior course interviews, they talk about their experience as being transformative in their lives. They talk about their opportunities, their relationships with their fellow students and faculty, and they talk about the sense of friendship, family, and community they've got. Time for a quick reality check. While I am definitely a glass half full kind of guy, the DHC is not without its challenges. We struggle too at times and need to push back against some of today's higher education trends and voices from the kids. Make your classes bigger and hire more instructors for less money. Finish a big chunk of your college education before you come to the university and get it done. The more technology, the better. Can we do it online and in a synchronous format? Well, and really, your education is just about getting a job. No longer a poor explorer, no time for wonder, no time to be curious. Tough luck. Just get it. In today's polarized society, you really better avoid being against mainstream your potentially controversial topics. Not to mention budget issues. Honors education is expensive. Do we really need it? So while there is medical research behind most of these well-intentioned voices, perhaps it's no surprise, but my response to the last question is a resounding yes. Next slide. Do we need honors education? Now more than ever. It's time, I think, to return to this work. So where does all of this lead us? We discussed research and ways of knowing, and a little about our unique approach to honors education at the University of Montana. And the powerful ideas around blowing minds, opening hearts, rocking worlds, and making meaning. So what do I hope you'll take with you? Next slide. First, I hope you'll take some measure of pride in the amazing people who can be exciting to do an important work of research, creating a scholarship and honors education at this great university. They are examples of experts who are attacking the world's big issues and preparing our next generation of leaders to do the same. Next slide. able to tap into a sense of wonder and possibility for a continuing mission of learning and discovery for all that we still don't know. Rebelling wrote, and it is a witness of our ignorance that is at the heart, and it is a witness of our ignorance is at the heart of scientific thinking. It is thanks to this awareness of the limits of our knowledge that we have learned so much. We are exploring the borders of our knowledge. For my part, I prefer to look ignorance in the face, accept it, and seek to look just a bit further to try to understand. Not just because accepting this ignorance is the way to avoid being entangled in superstitions and prejudices, but because to accept our ignorance in the first place seems to me to be the truest, the most beautiful, and above all, the most honest way. To seek to go further seems to me to be one of the slightest things that gives things to life, like loving or looking at the sky, the curiosity to learn, to discover, to look over the next hill, the desire to taste the apple. These are the things that make us human. The world is more extraordinary and profound than any of the deepest biological powers. I want to go and see it. To accept uncertainty doesn't detract from our sense of mystery. In the conflict, we are immersed in a mystery of the beauty of the world. Third, I hope you'll take a renewed openness to the ideas and experiences whose lives and perspectives might be similar to or quite different from your own. And along with that, I hope it does the same thing with you, and you can use the transformative notion that you might not always think right. And that's okay. That's good and bad. That grows the mind. That opens the heart. That rocks the world. And then we have a possibility. And finally, I hope you remind yourself to come on out of the cave. The sun is shining and the world is waiting for you. Thanks very much. Thank you so much, Tim. That was very, very inspiring. And from your lecture, what I took away is that mirroring the students' experience of discovery and working through the Alumni College, you also present an invitation to the rest of us that age is not a function of social learning, but there's always more to learn. And I particularly appreciated your speaking to the issues of empathy and willingness to be loving. I was reminded when you were talking about that of the experience of 40 or 50 years ago that Nichols announced he did The Ascent of Man, which was just a brilliant series that was on PBS. He echoed at the end the words of Oliver Cromwell when he was talking, when Bransky was talking about the experience that he thought about and the killing of and burning them. And he talked about the danger that comes from certainty, that you believe you're right, that allows you to do sometimes horrible things. And he harkened back to Oliver Cromwell's words, I beseech you of the cause of Christ to believe you may be wrong. And I think that was kind of what I was taking away from what you were talking about tonight. So to the audience, if you have questions and you'd like to post questions or make comments, please do so in the chat function, and we'll be receiving them, and when we get them, we'll be able to take up with them. If you post them, I believe there's an option for you to post them to all participants. Do that so everybody can see what your questions or your comments are. If it's a little echoey where I am, it's because I played the word again. Over to the news feed. I did
didn't get the message because I didn't pick up my phone. If I got the video, maybe not one. But we will be meeting here next week. So if you have any questions, let's go ahead and pop them up.
Jeff, I might just respond quickly to your comment about the page. I want to just give a shout out to them. Several of them on the screen. Those are my friends from years of my past, those are lifelong learning institutes. I think that the Maori community, especially the PhD program, when I'm seeing their list of courses and the serious topics and the level of learning they bring to it, it's just really inspiring. So yeah, it's not just for the young ones.
So I appreciate it while we're waiting for questions and comments to come in. I would appreciate it as a follow-up of what the graduates of the Davidson College are up to. They're going forth to the world and taking their knowledge and their talents and their energy, and they seem to be doing good work. And, you know, as an alum of the university, that makes me proud. A lot of our graduates of the university do that. But without the programmatic benefits of the Honors College, I just wish that we could follow more of our graduates and the good work that they do after their years here at the university. So, I don't see any questions or comments coming in yet.
Something else that I just every time I get a free job, but no, everybody reaches on that here in a minute, but I would be remiss as I see in my top right corner that Nancy Davidson has joined on this video. Certainly, everything that we do in the Davidson Honors College is made possible through the Richard's long commitment and generosity in the Nancy and the family. So, it's always wonderful to see the Davidsons, and we want to send a special thanks to them as well.
Yeah. Okay, thank you for the question. Thanks for your study to come in. Yes, thank yous, of course. Robert Stubblefield says thanks. And Katie, one of our committee members, asks, how has imparted ways of knowing with students changed in your years as an educator, if at all? Has the pedagogy changed for you?
So that's a great question. Thank you, Peggy. Another reminder of Molly Jones. I think the biggest change that I have seen in an approach to the course like ways of knowing, and I think that this is true at the Davidson Honors College and true more broadly nationally, and that is letting the mechanics and the text shift and evolve with the times. So certainly, our students read lots of classic literature and classic, and that is also exciting for them to encounter in their countries and also from different cultural backgrounds and traditions. So I think in terms of content with ways of knowing, that's probably been the biggest change. I'm not positive that's what you're getting at,
Green Bill Clerk also had a comment. He says, thank you for the presentation. I particularly enjoyed the reflections you shared on the insight we have in residing in compassion. How can we invest in compassion in our structures of learning? I'm interested in equity and access. And how do we can share opportunities to all, including diverse indigenous communities?
that's a wonderful question, Dr. Duckford. Thank you, and then for that, I'm going to speak to you. And thank you. There are, for me, the passion is a core value. And so, I'm trying to bring them to the college and to the work that I'm doing. Approaches we can take, whether it's through activities that we conduct with, through classes, the way that the kinds of materials that the kinds of stories that students encounter, the kinds of projects that they engage with, the kinds of speakers and voices that they're learning from, and certainly more Indigenous faculty, bringing more Indigenous students to higher education at your best, making sure that they feel welcome in the community.
Great, and then we have one other one. Thanks for a wonderful reminder that the treasure of the University of Montana is the all Missourians and our state. I so appreciate the specific references to the growth of students as they are challenged in multiple ways. And then also from Devin Hunt, thank you, Dean Nichols, your leadership, genuine spirit, and love of knowledge continue to be an inspiration to those of us who have been fortunate to learn from and alongside the incredible community of the PhD.
Well,
really,
that's so kind. Thank you, and I'll pop on this guy, he's going to get his own slide.
Yeah.
So that's great. Wonderful to have you all together. Not today, but that one.
Yeah. Again, to reiterate that comment, is the foundation of this entire lecture series is the treasure that the University of Montana is for the people in Western Montana and Missoula. Again, this is a reminder to us all the wonderful things that are happening on campus that we otherwise would never know about if we didn't have a lecture series like this, where we're able to go out among the faculty and select people who are doing exciting, interesting, fascinating things and share them with the community. It's something that our volunteers, Peggy, who are at Rogers Public Field, and the stalwart, our founder, Katie Robbins, who has just been a rock for 25 years. Every year, this is a labor of love for all of us on the committee. We always start with, well, what are we going to do this year? And it always ends up, I think, at least in my experience, it's always a surprise how wonderful it ends up being. The beginning when we start, it's just a big question mark. The university and the faculty come through for us, they come through for the community, they come through for us on this lecture series. So, supporting some, support the university, support the Alumni Association and their great work. If you have a chance tomorrow when you're visiting with people, tell them about this lecture. Tell them about the great things that you learned tonight. Share that the university is alive and well, and good things are happening here. That it is a service to the state of Montana, but the University of Montana is here and functioning with the great faculty that we have. So I don't see any more questions or comments. So I will bring us to a close and remind everyone that we will be meeting again next week at the University Center and online. So please find to join us in person. Bring a friend, sponsor a student, bring your child, bring whatever you want, and share this great experience with the others in the community. So with that, everyone, please stay warm, stay safe, and keep your walks covered.
Recording stopped.
Thank you all.